The park's always really fun, but getting to go up in a helicopter and view it from that perspective or flying through it on an airboat just definitely give you a different perspective of the nature out there.
Once I got more involved with it and started going outside, doing all the field work on airboats, or even just swamp walking in the Everglades National Park, and then I see all this stuff, and I'm like, wow, yeah, this is spectacular.
The Everglades is really the model for wetland restoration around the world.
Almost everything boils down to the Everglades down here.
Hey, it's Michael with Outside Science Inside Parks. For this episode, we're focusing on plants and water in one of the wettest national parks, the Everglades. Park scientists use satellite maps, airboats, and helicopters to understand how the vegetation in the Everglades is changing.
It's a major component of the comprehensive Everglades restoration project. Before they go in and alter the flow of the water and try to restore the historic water flow of the Everglades, we're going to be able to map it prior to that.
What it is we're trying to figure out what exactly is at any given location so that when we go back to the office and view it from the aerial point of view, we already have a sense of what's happening there so we can call the community what it is as accurately as possible.
When I put these 3D glasses on right here, especially when I'm looking at this mirror, everything pops out and I see the heights of each plants that I see in there, or I see which colors, because depending which spectral band you select on, you see certain species that are really vibrant and you say, oh, that's a red mango right there.
This is the Baccharis amelifolia. It sort of creates this natural history of the landscape that may otherwise not be there.
70% trees.
We have a group of were originally interns, and when this project came around, we tapped into their knowledge and their resources to help us map.
It provides a venue for me to sort of translate what I learned in the classroom, put it to actual use before I head on to do maybe some independent research.
So we sort of have this land, air, and sea sort of approach to our mapping. We're basically can approach any site through multiple means.
Right now, we are in Taylor Slough in the southern Everglades.
Height of vegetation class.
Science is not always doesn't always take place in the classroom or, you know, in the lab. This is one of the aspects of science and data collection that not a lot of people get to experience.
We're going to be looking at plots, and we're going to be classifying the vegetation by majority in each plot.
Everything you see till 50 meters that way.
Yesterday was fun. We went up in the helicopter to collect training points where we fly over 50 by 50 meter grid cells to basically assess what the community is at that location and look at the species present and determine what we're going to call it.
Well, my degree actually is in education, environmental education, and I think it's one of the most important things that we can do is pass on that legacy of preserving nature and conservation to the next generation, and I hope to continue to do it in the future.
And that's, I think, most important things that it's based in our tradition as humans to pass on our information from one generation to the other. And so as an educator or as a team leader, being able to sort of mentor and bring young scientists along is always very rewarding.
Who knew a morning commute could be so much fun? That's what happens when you take science outside of a lab. Thanks for watching Outside Science Inside Parks. Check us out next month when we go deep into the caves of Arkansas.